Moira was speaking in a languid, petulant voice. Esther, not listening, looked speculatively at the flesh that hung like the rich fruit of autumn from her chin, at the built-up, dewy complexion and the lines that showed heavily through it like pencil marks. She was a woman who could have no enthusiasms apart from the preservation of her exterior, but when Harry smiled at her tenderly, her face became animated. Esther was shocked by the realization that a woman of Moira's age could still be interested in love. Harry must see her for what she was. Esther jumped up.
Morgan gave me some money for you. I must get it.
She hurried from the room, brushing past Morris as he returned. I've telephoned London, he said. That's fixed. Harry followed her and stood beside her in the dark hall. She turned on him.
He's going away with father's money. He won't come back. He'll go to Ireland. We'll never hear of him again. Be quiet. I don't want comfort. I want father's money back again.
There's a lot of worry about money. It may be easier in the end to have no money at all. It's a rash thing I'm doing, to try to change my manner of living just because I love you, Esther. It's for you I'm grossly interfering with things that would be better left alone. We'll have money to last a time, Harry said confidently. Esther didn't listen.
I don't believe Morris was telephoning his broker. I'd like to find out whom he was telephoning, she said fiercely, looking at Harry, trying to force the thought from her head to his.
You could ask the exchange.
Oh, no, she protested in a shocked voice, still looking at him intently.
Your standards are too high, he said ironically, and she saw that he understood that she was begging him to do what she wouldn't do herself. It seems that by having no moral qualities at all, I'm just the man you want. A little spying will leave my self-respect quite intact.